First of all, I would like to. The aim of this paper is to show the new evidence from the Chalicote excavations within a broader historical framework that can provide new theories on the formation of the first complex civilizations on the Iranian plateau. In this perspective, first, the most recent results from the field work, carried out in Area 33 in Chalicote will be shown, and only then will the new evidence be analyzed in a broader historical context. So according to the agreement signed between the Research Institute of Cultural Heritage and Tourism of the Islamic Republic of Iran and the University of Salento, supported by Iranian Center for Archaeological Research and the Italian Ministry of Foreign Affairs, a new international project is started in 2017, hosted by Iranian Archaeological Mission, led by Mansour Sajjadi. The project explores the economical and societal transformations in Eastern Iran, Central Asia, and the Indus Valley from the end of the 4th to the beginning of the 2nd millennium BC, using a multidisciplinary and interdisciplinary approach to the Chalicote archaeological researches. The archaeological research in Chalicote between January 2017 and December 2019 allowed to reconstruct, still partially, the stratigraphic sequences of Area 33, located, as you can see in the slide, between the central quarter and the so-called monumental area. The choice of the area was made following preliminary surface survey, assisted by satellite and drone images, which yielded numerous clues about the area's potential. In particular, far more evidence than the others convinced us to start new excavations activities in Area 33. First of all, this is a video, maybe I can show you better. Using this video, Area 33 is located exactly here, in that part, and satellite, geomagnetic survey, and aerial images made it possible to identify underground structure of significant dimensions in that area. Also by this video, it's possible to see here structure underground, very, very clear. So this was one of the main reasons just to start our excavation in Area 33. The second one is related to the ceramic horizons that we know on the field that show strong similarities with phase 4-3, Chalicote period, with some more sporadic references to phase 5 and 6, a period perfectly in line with our research priorities, which were focused on the investigation of Chalicote period 2 and 3. The third period, the reason was for numerous fragments of alabaster vessels concentrated on the wall sector, which, together with fragments of worked lapis lazuli, made the area to be investigated promising. And finally, this is another video, the topographical location of the area was immediately interesting because of its proximity to the small lake near the site. The relations between the settlement and the depression area had to play an essential role in the process of growth and degrowth of the settlement during its entire lifespan. As you can see, Area 33 is here, and this is the inner lake, very, very close to the excavation area. Conducted so far have made it possible to identify four occupational phases with an interrupted stratigraphic sequence, although with the evidence of contraction in phase 2. Now, before showing you the new archaeological evidence from Chalicote, however, I would like to present the first results of C14 analysis from the excavated stratigraphic context. The determination of a new absolute chronology in Chalicote was in fact possible thanks to the analysis carried out by Cedar of Lecce, which allowed to change in part the old chronologies proposed by Maurizio Tosi. The necessary premise is that even in the past, François Jarrige had already questioned the chronologies of the Italian mission by raising the whole sequence by about half a millennium. Recently, Barbara Irving, Massimo Vidale, Hussein Fazelin Najdi had proposed a new chronology that was more or less halfway between what Tosi had proposed and what French archaeologists had hypothesized, as you can see also in the slides. Now, the C14 chronology proposed for our area are absolutely in line with the proposal of Barbara, Massimo, and Hussein, so Elvin, Vidale, and Fasoli. And as you can see, they are about 2 centuries higher around. So the new dates significantly change many considerations about systems' historical role, which, however, cannot be dealt in this presentation. Surely will be presented in the next one, preliminary report on our excavation in Chelles of Tade. The first one is in the slides. And on this basis, we can identify, at least as I told you before, 4 different phases for Area 33. The phase one is of course, the last one phases. We don't have any kind of occupation after this layer. And the second one is a squatter occupation. The third, so-called, we identified also a large building called House of the Courts. And the last one, so the earlier, then is the phase four with the so-called House of the Architects and the Eastern Building, all dating around phase six or period two of Chalais-sur-Tête. This is the sum of our archaeological excavations with all the phases. But now in details, we analyzed each single phase just later. I would like to show you, of course, the different phases. And these sequences are in a period of great transformation that involved not only the major center system, but also the entire Iranian plateau. I would like also to see you the final results of our excavations with our reconstruction made by Giuseppe Minaia. We should now we have to understand well what we want to do, but probably we can use also this area for a touristic use, also with a new work about restoration and to preserve, of course, the entire building that you can see from north to south and from to east to west in this very quick video. This is our last operation. Now we can start our single presentation of single stage, single phase. Phase four is the last investigated. It's open to continue excavating the entire sector, both in amplitude to fully understand the buildings identified, and vertically to return a definitive sequence of the entire area that, from small clues, allow us to hypothesize a structural continuity even for the most archaic phases of the settlement, probably to be recognized in phase seven of the site. The excavated area returned 2 buildings whose walls were only partially reused with the next phase, the first one and the second one, the House of the Architects and the Eastern Building. To the west, you know, these buildings were separated by road L148, this one, consisting of a well-paved floor with medium-sized stones used to solve the problem of water drainage. To the west of L148, of this street, a large architectural complex has been identified that develops on a southeast-northwest axis parallel to the course of the walls of the second building that rises to the east of the above street. Its eastern perimeter walls overlooking the above road. The so-called L148 allow to recognize at least three rooms with longitudinal axis 167, 169, and 176. If 167 remains misunderstood for limited archaeological investigation, 176 for its size and the valuable workmanship of its walls seems to represent a large courtyard whose western and southern limits still remain unexcavated. It also seems probable that one of the entrances to the building was secured by a passage in W158. This is the wall of the later phase, of course. This is the right wall of this phase, phase four. And as you can see here, should be a door, and we have also the door socket in R216. So a passage later closed, probably during the construction works of the next phase, with the creation of the so-called House of the Courts. The entire complex seems to be far from the architectonical tradition known in Charles-sur-Tech, well attested, for example, in phase three, with a slightly offset orientation compared to what is known in the other buildings excavated on the site. The presence, this is the entrance, the presence of a large space with a non-central entrance with respect to its perimeter wall is in fact an absolute novelty in the traditional Bronze Age system. The limited nature of the excavation does not allow further considerations of a typological nature. However, from a functional point of view, the distributive analysis of the artifacts appear significant. The presence of numerous accounting objects of an administrative nature, such as tokens, cretule, spherical objects, help to suggest for 176 a role related to the administrative activities for accounting and ordering actions. If it's surprising the high number of fragments of alabaster vessels from here, you have just some evidence. Even more significant is the presence of in L176 of 101 fragments of terracotta scales or annotation long barrel tablets. It's difficult to say, the work is in progress, so we are analyzing these pieces. All these terracotta scales or long barrel tablets with the numerical annotation was located in the northeastern corner of the L176. Here, probably part of a set used by the owner for the building. These graduated scales, which gave the house the conventional name of House of the Architect, provide evidence for the meteorological values of the site. The use, in fact, of graduated scales is also widely known along the Indus Valley and in the Gujarat region, where metric systems based on the local units of Kalibangan, Lota, Dholavira, Mohenjo-Daro, and Harappa have been hypothesized. Now you can see in the table each single unit used in the above sites. I can add that according to our samples, seems to be that the basic unit of Charles-sur-Tech should be around 1.10. On the contrary, in the Indus Valley, as you can see in the table, 1.7, 1.8. Why? Because it is evinced by the graduated scales found in L176, whose engraved lines are 1.1 centimeter apart. Between the two lines, each single lines, there is in Charles-sur-Tech so-called scales 1.1 even. In this perspective, very interesting appear also the bricks used in this and the following phase, whose dimensions are 11, 10 times 1.1, 22, and 44 centimeter, according to a standard ratio 1 to 4, widely known through the civilization of Harappa. Although in the early Harappan period, the ratios can also be 1, 2, 3, most of the Harappan center, including the sites from in the Gagar Valley, in primis Rakigari, retard the same metric ratio, bringing Shaisokte closer to the meteorological experiences known in the major Indian sites. The house of the architect has two flooring phases for A and B, you can see in the slides. A very well-kept floor for both phases, in fact, covered with a thick layer of grey plaster, have been identified. The so-called Eastern Building, just simply because was found to the eastern part of the main street, is located east of the road, of course, L148, and must be considered an architectonical block separate from the house of the architect. Unlike the latter, no entrance has been found, perhaps located on the north side or, less likely, on the eastern front. The complex consists of at least two large rooms, 149 and 150. Here you can see only 149, defined by walls made of two horizontal rows of bricks with the same dimension or in ratios as those of the house of the architect, well preserved by a considerable thickness of grey plaster of very fine workmanship. Also in this building, two archaeological phases have been identified by two floors with a later change in the inner circulation of the building. There are two rooms. So you can see both now in these slides, this one and this one. In fact, we're communicating in a first phase through the wall W152, then closed by the addition of the wall W173, which definitely closed the passage. This structural change also had to drastically change the use of the rooms. The internal circulation, in fact, which had to be in the most archaic phase composed by an axial latitudinal development, changed for reasons not yet understood. On the basis of our knowledge, L149, this one, in other words, maintains communication with the northern sector thanks to two passages in W154, one of which with a door washer. Is here. The second one, socket door, is located here. And so we are sure about the first one, the second one, entrance in the room. This is all one room. We found also clear signs of the use of locking system with wooden beams embedded in the brick walls. This room returned a considerable amount of material, including seal impressions, tools for food processing, clay figurines, alabaster vessels, but above all, a very significant amount of cretulae and spherical objects used for administrative accounting. All the accounting objects were found the next of the jar placed in W152, not too far from the quadrangular oven, is here, perfectly preserved and lined towards the center of the room. The care of the walls, the manufacture of the floor, the articulated closing device, the presence of these administrative objects helped to hypothesize an accounting activities and holding function for this compartment. In this perspective, the closure, as you can see in the slides, of the passage between two rooms in a later phase could be due to a change in the control and the accounting activities of the economic resources of the building. If 149 room in phase 4A seems to be more central in the life of building, L150, this one, instead seems to lose its function. The closure of the passage in W152 seems to have led to an abandonment of the space in L150, as can be assumed by the filling excavated and completely different from 149. And above all, by the almost total absence of ceramics and objects, just one counter. The Eastern Building would undergo a strong downsizing in phase 4A, with the exclusion of an entire sector from its internal circulation. In other words, this part was not used. Of course, there are very small, very few samples of ceramic, but it is very strong. It is closely to the ceramic horizons that must fit into the phase 6 of Shiny Soté. The so-called phase 3 with the House of the Quartz has an architectonical complex that follows the traditional typology of the architectonical units of Shiny Soté 2, beginning 3rd period. Its entrance must have been on the northern side, later closed before its abandonment when the remaining structure became an area used for metalworking activity. The entire building consists of two large courtyards, one at the entrance, this one, and a central one, this one. Of course, these walls are relating to the earlier phase. These courtyards surrounded by numerous smaller rooms that were used for residential and storage functions, as we can see now. This architectonical typology is composed by two courtyards with a latitudinal axial path, mostly with the entrance on the southern side, and a variable number of peripheral rooms that are around the inner courtyard. The presence of the central courtyard ensured the circulation inside the building was assayed through this central block appeared to be obligatory to reach the peripheral sector of the housing complex. In other words, this planimetrical typology with some variables is widely known in the some buildings already excavated in Shiny Soté. The presence of the two axial courtyards, one at the entrance and one in the center, with peripheral room around it, in fact, has been identified in Building 20, in Building 1, partially in the House of the Pit, eastern part of the House of the Stairs, House of the Jars, in the House of Foundation, and in House excavated in XH Square. Building 1, excavated between 1999 and 2009 by Hossein Mouradi and Mansour Sajjadi, has returned six different construction phases, of which the first five are dating to Shiny Soté 2 and 3, contemporary to the House of the Quartz phases, while Building 20 has been placed in the last phases of the third and the first years of the fourth period of the site. In the same way, the House of the Stairs show four distinct architectonical phases, covering a chronological framework limited to the second period of the site, with very sporadic evidence dating to the third period. The first two phases are known in the central body, also structured on two pairs of courts in axis with each other, while the third phase is related to the eastern additional complex, which, as in the case of the House of the Courts, consists of two courts with latitudinal axis and a small entrance hall. Although not completely excavated, the House of the Jars also returns are structured with double courtyards and rooms around, very similar to what excavated in Area 33. The House of the Jars, excavated in the central quarter, must be dated to the period 2, although the wall area continued to be occupied until phase 3. So, the same chronological horizons as the House of the Pit in the eastern residential area, while the House of the Foundation seems to go as far as the third period. Although the presence of a courtyard with rooms around it, including also a stairway, is a typology known in the Indus tradition, especially in Mohenjo-Daro, so I don't know, see for example the green, the yellow, and the red, the typologies by Sarcina, the presence of two courts in axis with each other, as described above, appear to be a characteristic of Shiny Soté architectonical model. A standard architectonical typology that had in the first courtyard a wide sector whose function was to introduce towards an inner courtyard, mainly used for the internal circulation of the building. From it, in fact, all the peripheral rooms were reachable, with the exception of L219, and which presumably was related to the storage and ordering process. In other words, this part was not related directly from the central courtyard. The first court can be anticipated by an introductory room, as in the case in the eastern part of the House of the Stairs, House of the Pit, and House of the Foundation. I show you again. Or have a sort of small entrance, as known in Building 1 and 20. The House of the Courts of Area 33 returns a device with a direct entrance to the first court and a unique and obligatory passage to the second inner court. The chronological feature that emerges of this architectonical typology seems to be consistent with what was excavated in Area 33 between the end of the second and the beginning of the third period. This architectonical model, which perhaps had its first formulation with phase 7, seems to establish itself in Charly-sur-Thème, although with some variables. A typology known between phase 7 and phase 5. In a widespread way, with some archaic formulae to be recognized in Building 20, whose later occupation seemed to reach the early years of the fourth period. The House of the Courts has two subphases recognized by the layer sequences and by the presence of floor and wall-type restorations. In particular, the structural changes are to be recognized in the creation of a stairway obtained after having filled and closed with matrix the two eastern peripheral rooms of phase 3A. In other words, this one and this one was completely filled in the same phase, of course, in the same period, but in different phase. The new arrangement created an access to an hypothetical second floor or to the terrace of the building, and in the same way, determining a substairs known in A144. As with the eastern building of phase 4A, the structural changes modify the inner circulation of the building. The creation of a stairway along the eastern side of the building, in fact, moved the centrality of the house towards the western rooms 1 to 2. It seems possible to believe that in the final years of the House of the Courts, the residential part was on the second floor. It also seems likely that L122, this, and 142, this one, were two rooms used for recording and accounting of resources. The presence in both rooms of very large quantity of crapulae and seal impressions allow us to believe that this was a sector used for the registration of the quantities subsequently stored in L219, this one room. Further considerations can be made on this subject based on the fact that two compartments return very different types of seal impression. The distributive analysis of seals and seal impressions, in addition to providing an indication of the function of L122 and 142, helps indeed to recognize a relationship between the type of seal and the room where it was found. It seems rather significant that the same figurative system is confined in L142, while the similar production are all limited in L122. This type of evidence makes it possible to hypothesize the presence of two administrative cycles of the activities of ordering related to the family economy. In other words, the same impression, all the same in one room and very different in the other ones. In particular, if seals and their impressions in L142 belong to the most widespread geometric typology known in Charly-sur-Thème and to be considered a local production, often steatite or chlorite, the seals and impressions from L122 belong to cultural spheres to look for in Baluchistan. You can see here all the comparisons that we found in different regions on the eastern part, in the Tales, in Baluchistan, in the Punjab, in the Khyber Pakhtunkhwa, in Haryana, in Rajasthan, and also in Gujarat, with different sites that you can see in the upper part of the slide, on the table. In this case, the question arises whether these differences in the seal impressions from two architectonical units cannot be explained by a differentiation of storage process between locally and off-site goods. As with the ceramic evidence collected, the seals and their impressions are part of a chronological framework attributable to an initial period of phase five of the site, also according, of course, to the comparisons. The phase two. This phase represents a period of abandonment of the area. After the house of the courts, the entire area is abandoned for a limited period of years. The structure of phase three are used by sporadic occupation that use the persistent walls to support ovens and furnaces used for working mostly metals. The large furnaces found in the high concentration of copper waste show a profound change in the wall sector. This quarter phase interrupts the continuity of occupation in the area, which seems to lose its residential function. So the building of phase three is in fact definitively abandoned. The new installation for metalworking are built on its remains. The transition from the first half of the second half of the third millennium BC appears strong, although no traumatic evidence has been identified in the end of phase three. The house of the courts seems to be no longer used for causes difficult to understand without any violent event, simply through a progressive abandonment of the entire area. In area 33, the transition from the second to the third period seems therefore to show a radical change in the topographical layout of the site, which around the middle of the third millennium BC seems to show a definitive break in its occupation. This phase will again be overturned by a new leveling of the entire sector for the construction of building 33, was in phase 4 and 3, was planimetric and architectural feature, and its ceramic horizons show a strong break with what was known in the last years of the second choice of that period, during, of course, the House of the Courts. So we arrive to the phase one. Phase one show a very strong break with what was known in the previous periods, as I told you before. Although some wall structure seems to be partially reused, the orientation of the walls of phase three, the structural evidence, and the architectural module of building 33 is profoundly different from the topologies known in the second period of the site, and I showed before. The new architectural device of building 33 was occupation must be between the end of phase four and the entire phase three, follow architectural models until now completed unknown. The new complex, certainly much more monumental in size than the House of the Courts, showed the planning of a pre-established architectural plan even before its construction. Its articulation, the functional differentiation inside the building, the architectural rationalization of rooms and spaces, its circulation are all prerogatives unknown to the older tradition of Bronze Age system. In contrast to the building one, walls development seems to be proceed with the agglutinative and unplanned addition of new spaces or rooms. Building 33 returns a planned monumental complex divided into sectors and without additions that would change the planned architectural device. Due to the heavy rainfall and wind action, the entire building 33 show very strong sign of erosion of its structure, which are better preserved in the northern half and in a very limited way in the southernmost part. Due to the poor conservation of the elevations of the walls, in some cases preserved below the foundation, the circulation appears uncertain in the absence of clear references to passages or access doors. The situation appears even more critical towards the south part, where many of the walls are completely eroded and washed away by atmospheric agents. Building 33 has four different sectors with a division of space due to the functional requirements, a clear functional diversification that seems to be the result of precise programmatic plan, designed before construction and built according to the modules and architectural canons unknown to Sherisotta. In Building 33, at least four architectural bodies and an enclosure with specific function can be recognized. The kitchen area is the sector organized around four main rooms, 1, 2, 3, and 4, and one enclosure, this one, after we will see better. This quadrangular body allow us to recognize two fertile subdivision of a functional nature. The northern compartments, this one, were used for food processing, as shown by the numerous cutting and grinding tools found, and for the benches on which the operation were carried out. And the southern one, the southern compartment, were instead used for cooking food, as can be easily deduced from the numerous kilns found directly on the floor. This is another slide, quite clear. Of course, all the material in the kiln has been removed and now will be the subject of new C14 analysis. The kitchen sector was surrounded by an external area located in the northeastern corner of excavation area, in which a kiln, larger than those found inside the building, a quadrangular basin, presumably for water collection, and a white evidence of pits. This is the basin, this is the large kiln, were found. In this pit, we found also a lot, I have to say, animal bones. This external area must be considered as part of the kitchens, whose access was found along the W87 from this wall, as well tested by threshold here with the main entrance, identified just on that wall. At the present state of our knowledge, however, no evidence has been collected of a direct passage to the warehouses or to the areas devoted to the food processing. We have to add also the presence of a storage area just located in the northern part of this complex, where were found, probably used for processing, to support the processing and cooking actions, and is represented by four long and thin rooms with an east-west longitudinal axis, inside which numerous fragments of jars were found in situ. The presence of storage rooms in the northern area make it possible to hypothesize an internal circulation that, unfortunately, due to the strong damage of the structure, it's only possible to reconstruct on the basis of the functional destination of each single room. In particular, the northern warehouses of Building 33 help to believe in a north-south route that, from the peripheral compartments used for storage, had to reach the food preparation area and finally those intended for its cooking. The residential area, about the residential area, this is just a suggestion, of course, because we cannot assume the presence with the presence of a second floor. Anyway, the presence of a brick platform with dimension of about 2 meters of side, thickness of the wall surrounding the central courtyard that reach a thickness unknown to the wall building, could be an evidence about the presence of a second floor. We have also in other sites, as you can see, this kind of platform. Surely we have a courtyard or a public area. The Building 33 seems to be organized around a central courtyard represented by L19 wall size, the thickness of the walls, and the presence of a brick passage help to recognize an open space whose functions could have been reception and an introductory to the circulation of the northern sectors. The lack of knowledge of a main entrance, however, hypothesized on the southern side, make it more difficult to understand the court's device. In any case, the size of the room, around 5 to 4, 5 and 90, it's very accurate floor, unknown in the other rooms, for example, made of several layers of plaster, and the presence of a brick corridor in its western part helped to recognize in this room a central court that was used as a hinge between the articulated and complex sector for the kitchens in the northern and the luxury room of the building hypothesized in the south. Significant is the corridor, this one, made with bricks very close to the glazing. The measure was 10 for 30 for 60 centimeter, according to a ratio of 1:3:6, different than the use of a glazed brick corridor to cross the courts is widely known in later contexts in Shaisokai itself, taking area 26 in livres of the fourth period of the site in Eshnunna Telasmar at the governor's palace of Ur-3 period in Alak and finally in Chogazambi at the introductory courts of the temples of Shimut, Belen Ali, and Adad El Shala. In the absence of knowledge of the architectonical tradition of Eastern Bronze Age Iran, it seems particularly curious to recall a tradition that must have had particular fortune in Mesopotamia between the end of the third and the beginning of the second millennium BC, before its wider spread with the end of the second millennium BC and the Wall Iron Age. This glazed brick passage also helps to make further considerations about the circulation inside the building and overall plan of the Building 33. In fact, if we admit that at least two entrances to the court had to be located in W20, in other words, of course, here, this is the passage, and in W52, here, exactly where this kind of passage has been identified, we have a court with a longitudinal axis, east-west, whose passage was assured by a latitudinal south-north axis path along the room of short sides. This type of organization, so in other words, longitudinal development of the courts and a passage of latitudinal type is unknown in the traditional system and also in Shaisokai, of course. This device has its best comparisons in Susa, in the house of Rabibi, and in the Maison du Culte. In conclusion, the planning of the building, its architectonical rationalism, its rigid functional division, its wide articulation, the monumentality of its western front, and its position near the lake, all seem to be significant elements in trying to recognize Building 33 as a central architectonical complex in the urban planning of the center. In particular, for this specific evidence, it seems possible to believe that Building 33 may have been a building created by one of the elite of the center, a group that, with the third period in phase four and three, had to reach a prominent position within the articulated social system of Shaisokai. The overall nature of the court's device, which shows significant comparisons with the experiences known in the more Western context, together, and this is another evidence, with three ovoid balance weights, two with base, that seem to be easily connected to the Mesopotamian meteorological experiences, has interesting convergences with what is known at the necropolis of the site, where several tombs of phase 8-7 were reused in phase 4 and 3, allowing to Marcello Piperno and Sandro Salvatori to recognize a well-defined social group with clear Western morphological cultural convergences. In the eastern part of the excavation area, a very thin wall running from northwest to the southeast has been identified, dividing an open area from an enclosed space not completely investigated. The open area, as described above, should be considered as an inner sector of the Building 33 for the presence of W88 in phase with W76. Now, I don't want to bore you, but I mean, this wall is clearly in phase with this one. And this wall is the same wall of our building. So this enclosure should be considered part of this building. The above thin wall seems to define a new space to the east where no kind of material is being found, really, nothing. No objects and a very few quantity of shells have been collected. However, a well-preserved basalt work textile is not the only one. We found in this sector a lot of these kind of textiles used directly on the floors as well as attested in AL92 have been found. In a very preliminary analysis, we suggest that the main yard AL91, so this courtyard, open courtyard, surely open, was an open area mainly related to the kitchen sector, located to the west, in which stronger burning activities were carried out to support the food transformation process known in this main room. We have other kiln here, here. At the same time, the small and very thin walls bordering to east with the yard, with the courtyard, with this, be seen as an enclosure. Frankly speaking, it's difficult to say for what. I don't want to go on, but small animals. In this perspective, we should also get some considerations. No shells we have. Carpets were found. The most part of bones found in the refuse pit belong to the kitchen, to the chickens, and they have to be related to the burning process known in the kitchen area, here, located here, and in the main rooms. And four fixed balls here and here were found for animals. I don't know. Anyway, well, this is the pottery coming from the Area 33. Now, and some objects. Now, we don't have so much time to describe each single horizon and typology of objects. Anyway, summing up in the excavation of Area 33, we can identify four different phases. In the future, we would like also to investigate the earlier part and to go down over the phase six using the Maurizio Tosi proposal, periodical proposal. Anyway, this period, first half of the third millennium BC, and just very beginning of the second part of the third millennium BC, will fit into a broader framework of international dynamics in which the cultural path appear similar to those of the Greek, other Greek river civilization. I mean, Oxus, Indus, and the Halil River. So, in the same period of Area 33, in Charybdis-Opte, from phase 1 to 4, in our periodical sequences, Giroft, Harappa, and Oxus culture during the mid of 3rd millennium BC had a similar settlement development. These regions increased and developed an autonomous and original cultural horizon unknown to the previous periods, although through different processes. During this period, the changes identified in the Ilmand from Charybdis-Opte 2 to 3, Indus with the new period in Harappa 3a, Halil Valley in primis with the growth of Konar Sandal, and in Central Asia, the emergence of the Nammatska fifth culture, were simultaneous and homogeneous as well as known in the break of their cultural and archaeological sequences. Of course, there is an inner homogeneity. However, so during around the mid-third millennium BC, we observe the simultaneous break in the emergence of Halil, Ilmand, Oxus, and Harappa culture. In Western Central Asia, the Nammatska fifth period witnessed a transformation of society and the appearance of cities showing the same break we know in Charybdis-Opte 2-3 transition. The period is marked by technological advances in pottery production, and especially in metallurgy, with deliberate alloying and evidence for local production in the form of copper smelting furnaces. A successive cultural continuity in the Murghab Depression is attested by the evidence from Namask and Altyn Tepe, where recent excavations have permitted the suggestion that there was a local emergence of the later BMAC. Similar evaluation can be made also for the evidence collected in AGQE1, where a continuous chronological sequence has been identified from 2008 to 1700 BC, 7, 800, supporting the hypothesis of an indigenous development of the so-called Oxus civilization. In the same period, the Ilmen Valley show a cultural development well documented in the archaeological phases of Mundigak 413 and Shaisoktat 23, while in a process of cultural continuity starting from the beginning of the fourth millennium BC, the so-called Harappan Indus culture began in the period 3, with the evidence of a new administrative control system, writing, weights, seals, and a new organization of urban space in its surrounding landscape, in which new Harappan enclaves were established on the Makran coast, see in primis, of course, Mirkalat and the Shor Tugai, near the Lapis mines in Bactria. At the same period, the so-called Giraffe civilization is well attested in Konar Sandal and along the Alin Valley, allowing to identify an articulated social structure with wide evidence of contacts with Western Mesopotamia, Southern Persian Gulf, and Eastern areas, Indus. All of this evidence points to the indigenous developments of the Ilmen, Giraffe, Indus, and Oxus civilization. However, new archaeological data from each region will allow the identification of change in Eastern Iran, the Indus Valley, Central Asia, all around the middle of the third millennium BC, a change originating from a local cultural development and probably conditioned by a new socio-economic system now launched towards a more articulated control of its territory and far regions. In this period of great transformation, an integrated cultural system, from now ECS, appear around the middle of the third millennium, a period in which a high number of imported and exported materials were found in the main sites of Iranian islands, Central Asia and South Asia. At the same time, there originated a new syncretic cult linking the different cultural heritages of the main fluvial civilization. Of course, one thing is the exported material or imported. Another thing is the syncretic production that we know well in this period. This interactive and integrative period was not, however, homogeneous, and during the end of the third millennium BC, a new break in the local sequence of Iranian, the DAAC, and Indus sites is attested. Two main phases, indeed, must be identified on the basis of the ceramic assemblage. You can see here the phases identified in proto early and late ECS. But two main phases indeed must be identified on the basis of ceramic assemblage, material culture, archaeological phases, and settlement analysis. In the system region, a change in the material culture is known in the Shaisoktat 4, while same changes were identified in Tahab 3231 and Yahya 4b4a. In the Oxus civilization, a so-called Golur phase began in late ECS. A new 3C period commenced in the Indus Valley, while a radical change was also documented in Shor Tugai 3 and Lilikalat 4 periods. Similarly, two sub-phases were identified in the uninterrupted sequence identified in the AGQE I told you before. This is the period, end of third millennium BC, in which the earliest fortified palaces appear at Keleli with square towers, and Gonur, where two separate fortified compounds were identified. Gonur North, a city of around 50 hectares, has allowed to know monumental palaces built in the irregular Lausanne-shaped wall, with private houses, storerooms, craft workshops, water basin, and animal pens, and so on. Furthermore, the recent archaeological exploration at Konar Sandal have confirmed an internal division of ECS period in the Giraffe Tyria. The archaeological phases and the material culture of Konar Sandal support a change in the cultural horizons of northern Alil around 2200. Konar Sandal South was abandoned. Up now. So, the last operations were identified, in fact, in the upper phase of Citadel, where maps of the previous period in French 3 were used as filling in the western side city of the wall. In the same period, the settlement seems to have shifted towards the north, where the terrace of Konar Sandal North was built. Okay, the absolute chronology, as you can read here, is based also with the C14 analysis carried out by other archaeological expeditions. The same changes are attested in the cultural horizons of Indus Valley. In particular, the revisited chronology and stratigraphies of Harappan excavation help allow us to identify a break between phase 3a-B and 3c, a settlement discontinuity were represented at Chandaru by a sudden abandonment of carnelian workshop while attested on the site during 3a and 3b sub-phases. In the same period, significant changes have been found in the Mohenjo-Daro ceramic repertory, as documented in the excavation of the granary area, the citadel, and the late layers of DKG sector. In other words, we have really a simultaneous break here and also in the inner phases of the so-called ECS period. On this basis, we can state that a trans-regional period characterized by intercultural relations was born in the mid-millennium BC, with two main archaeological sequences and cultural developments. A period in which Shaisokta, Shadad, Konar Sandal, Gonur Depe, and in general the main Indus Valley sites carried out a meaningful role in the early Bronze Age historical dynamics. Starting with the building 33 in Shaisokta, equivalent to the phase 4-3 in archaeological periods by Tosi, mature Indus and the full urban phase in Kopet Dag were born. First, palatial compounds in Marjana with the appearance of Gonur North Palace and the city. We have the Girof Valley that shows an intensive settlement development, and the main site of Konar Sandal seems the control of northern Alin. A regional cultural development is now replaced by an integrated cultural system where wide evidence of imported and exported material is documented. An increase in the artifacts is generated by an artistic syncretism, and Girof and Marjana seem to play an important role in its diffusion and elaboration. We will see after, just now. We know from the Mesopotamian text that forced relations with Mesopotamia appear. In the late ECS, we have an integrated system of contacts continue with further development of Oxus VMAC civilization. A new cultural phase is now attested in Elam, Haftari period, and the new iconographic relations identified between Anshanite seals and the Oxus silver vessels. New colonies were established at Shortugai, Sotkako, and Sutkagendor, while stronger up interferences in a local sequence are now found in Mirikala 4 period and Balakot. A so-called Gonur Depe phases in Marjana and the Konar Sandal settlement radically changes. New contacts are attested with the western entities of the Persian Gulf, and the diplomatic relations were developed with Ur-3 and Easy Mesopotamian kings. Significant activities of Indus Valley commercial organization are attested on the western coast of the Persian Gulf. Around the 18th century, this period ceased dramatically, and a crisis within each regional context is attested both by its main sites and the regional settlement analysis. At the end of this period, the Oxus, Indus, Ilman, and Girof civilization collapsed. The Kaftari period in Fars was substituted by a new cultural regional phase. Mirikalat, Shortugai, Tepeyai, Shaisokta were abandoned, and settlement Shadad. And Shadat was drastically reduced, probably. The emerging picture confirms that during the third and the beginning of the second millennium, relations between different worlds intensified. This period suddenly ceased for reasons which are not yet fully understood. At the beginning of the second quarter of the second millennium, the BCE settlement crisis seems to have struck southeastern Iran, the Oxus culture, and the Indus Valley, revealing the same historical development in Bactrian and Marjan archaeological complex, Girof Valley, Takap Plain, Baluchis, and Indus regions. The general suggestions about the collapse of Ilman, BMAC, Indus civilizations have been focused on the climatic changing with the sudden emergence of strong conditions of aridity in which the nomadic element was able to better deal with the new environmental conditions. Marjana, Indus, Iranian plateau settlement pattern collapse, showing a radical and contemporary cultural changing. One of the aim of our project in Shai Sokhta, according also to with the Iranian mission, is just to investigate, to understand what's happening in the beginning of the second millennium BC. This is just a slide in which I try to resume all the interactions, all the objects we are going on, the material, archaeological material, well known from the excavations, also private market, in which it's possible to identify exported material, imported, and also the evidence of syncretism artistic presence in this period. We can go again after if you prefer, but just to show you some evidence about this. Syncretistic art is well attested by, for example, the so-called goddess or queen or princess, presented also recently by Massimo Vidale, from the Oxus. This kind of evidence is widely attested, widely known, diffused on the southeastern Iranian glyptic art in the past, also called Trans-Elamite by Pierre Amier. In the 1986, but anyway, this is a very clear evidence about this strong interaction, not just related to the economic and commercial trade, but a very syncretic art due to the asyncretic view about the product, this kind of production. As you can see, all here you have all the seals coming from the southeastern Iran, but this kind of evidence is widely known also in the Oxus heritage. The same way, also this very famous kind of production, the so-called princess or goddess with large skirt, realized, made in the Oxus, is widely attested in the Anshanite seals. We have Anshanite seals mainly coming from Susa, but found also in a large number also in Talimayan. And as you can see, this kind of iconography is well known on the so-called Eastern group of seal coming from Susa and Talimayan. But there are a lot of evidence. Just this morning, we have seen another one with the seal. This morning, I mean, during this conference in which has been presented also the so-called Ligabue seal, in which iconography coming from Harappa, inscription coming in linear Elamite, and the icon, some part of the iconographies are coming from southeastern Iran, is a witness about this interaction production. This is another kind of production of so-called syncretistic art, in which you can see this seal has been in the past published, Harappan signs, iconography coming from southeastern Iran, probably also coming according to the Kaunakes used in this seal, and the three petal flowers, very, very diffused in the seals of southeastern Iran. Anyway, the morphology of the seal is a cylinder stamp seal with the handle on the top, a very diffused typology in the Central Asia. So we are in front of a seal with a typology probably influenced by the experiences of Central Asia. We have that iconography coming from the southeastern Iran and inscription clearly from the Harappan sites or the greater Indus. Other kind of relations, so the syncretistic art are the so-called silver vessels, most of them coming from Oxus, not all, also from Iran, of course, but more many of them with the Elamite inscriptions and with the iconography, the Oxus iconographical repertoire. The relations between culture, so were owing not only to one reason, but were conditioned by multiple factors, principally to identify in new resources with concomitant shifting alliances between pastoralist and sedentary populations. In the emergence of managerial hierarchies with expanding lineage alliances and increasing class stratification in the new urban context. When the new urban organization, rising around 2400, for example, in Marjan and Bactria, was able to give political, administrative, and commercial answer to the demands of Southeastern Iran, Indus, and Helmand entities, in this case, a new intercultural period was born. However, the rise of the Oxus civilization was local, uninterrupted, and directly generated by indigenous development from the previous period, with a stimulus coming from the southern neighboring regions. With the urban period in Central Asia, the same sites were stimulated, or better to say, in the successive period in Central Asia, the same sites were stimulated by an international relationships. Organizing a wider and more articulated commercial network in order to supply raw material to their community. In this historical picture, Shahi Soltai and Gonur Depe represented a bridge towards the Bactrian and Sogdiana mountains, where numerous mines for raw materials were exploited. In this perspective, the fortune of Shahi Soltai, Gonur Depe, and Shaddad, in one hand, was related to their geographical position in a supply area representing a restricted zone towards Central Asia and the southeastern Iran, as well as documented by numerous metallurgical and semi-precious stone workshops, respectively found at Shaddad and Shahi Soltai, and by a substantial presence of raw material which were collected from surface. Also, it's not so easy for you, but anyway, just two final considerations about the organization of social organization that we can suppose imagine for Shahi Soltai. From a historical point of view, the data collected from the excavation in Shahi Soltai has enabled us to hypothesize about the specific economic and social structure of the site, where different people with different ideological and social costumes were living in the city. We can use assume that probably the city was not ruled or controlled by a centrally organized system, but rather by a confederation between different tribes and clans. This is usually this is the theories most used. In this perspective, the political structure of northeastern and eastern Iran and Central Asia is similar. Both regions seem to be organized in a semi-sedentary structure with a strong political role carried out by the tribal nomadic presence on territory, with very far to the state centralization well known in Egypt, Mesopotamia, and southern Iraq, as you can see in the slide, and the Indus Valley from the half of the third half of the third millennium BC. In other way, we have different kind of social organization, and not only, in the Near East, in the Central Asia, in the South Asia. And the so-called segmentary state is ecological theories advanced in the 60s, as another theories about the social organization in the all societies is the so-called heterarchic structure, well presented also in the Greater Indus, also by Massimo, and in which this kind of structure is organized in coalition federations, in other example of shared human groups, interacting, of course, among them, need not to be permanently ranked relative to one another. This hierarchy model can be applied in different aspects of human organization, of course, such as scale, power, and values, and we assume that Shahi Soltai was the result of a demographic aggregation based on own tribal lineage. I tried also in my last one of my last publications to define, to identify some archaeological marker about this hierarchical model. As I told you, is a very it's not so new, this model. It has been proposed during the 50s and in the 60s too, and applied in the tails, in particular in the Indus Valley. Anyway, all the markers that I try to identify are present in shades of time in different way, but are present, as you can see in the slide. Now, maybe we don't have so much time, but we can come back again. In details, the system should be considered an historical laboratory. The system should be considered an historical laboratory in which it will be possible to identify different processes and models of urban developments. Far from the urbanization known in southern Mesopotamia and Egypt, of course, comparing the archaeological evidence from shrines of Thebes with the so-called Marrakesh region and the greater Indus, it will be possible to obtain new information about the growth process of the Helmand Basin in order to build up new theoretical models on the transmissions, integrations, interferences among cultures during the third and the beginning of the second millennium BC. Now, when I was invited to write my thoughts on the complex form of civilization in Iran in the third millennium BC, two very dear people passed away. Sandro Salvatori and Malek Shamir Zadi. I didn't know them so well because I had not a regular personal acquaintance with them, but for having read many, if not all, of their studies from a young age, I have to say that they will be much missed in my personal research. Thank you. Thank you for your attention. I'm sorry if I was long. Thank you.